Murder and mayhem.
Someone's gonna die tonight. It's not gonna be you or him.
Teenagers convicted of one of Lee County's most notorious crime sprees.
Because we live with the pain of Mark's death every day.
Now, more than two decades later, the NBC2 investigators go behind prison walls.
Do you think he deserves a death penalty?
To uncover why the ringleader sentenced to die is still alive.
The Lords of Chaos terrorized Lee County for weeks, burning down the historic Coca-Cola plant on US 41 and then killing their teacher at his home.
The ringleader, Kevin Foster, was 18 when he was arrested, later convicted and sentenced to death. Tonight, he's 39, living on your dime at the Union Correctional Institution in North Florida. NBC2 investigator Trent Kelly tracked down why.
Well, Kevin Foster keeps appealing his sentence, the most recent one denied just a couple of weeks ago. His victim's family tortured by every court proceeding. I talked to another member of Foster's gang from inside prison.
I really didn't think they were going to go that far.
A 17-day crime spree.
I was curled in a ball on the front seat just rocking back and forth saying, oh God.
By a gang of teenagers.
All I heard was the two gunshots. That was it.
Ending with murder.
Did you know you were about to help kill your teacher?
I didn't think we were going to do it. I really didn't think it was going to go through.
From his prison cell in Hardy County, Derek Shields recounts the night that changed his life.
I look back all the time and, you know, I could have stopped it from the beginning.
Shields was 18 years old when he became an honorary member of the Lords of Chaos, led by Kevin Foster, a former student at Riverdale High.
I feared him. I feared him big time. He was a likable guy until you learn that he is a sicko.
Shields, Foster, and two other teens tracked down Shields' band teacher, Mark Schwiebes, at his home in Pine Manor because they worried he could connect them to another crime.
When Schwiebes did finally come to the door, I turned back around and tried to follow through what I was thinking about, trying to push him out the way, and I froze, and then I took off. And when I heard that second shot, I thought that was me. I really thought that second one was me.
Not only was it tough, it was like out of body, unbelievable.
Schwiebe's sister, Pat, recalls the moment she learned her brother was gone.
I got a phone call from my father. My dad was very upset. He was crying and he told me that Mark was dead. Well, did he die in a car accident? You know, what happened? And he said, no, he was murdered.
Shields and two other teens took plea deals. Foster went to trial and was sentenced to death. More than two decades later, Foster remains on death row, costing taxpayers more than $440,000.
It's a slow process. They take a lot of time. The courts are jammed.
Joe D'Alessandro was the state attorney when Foster was convicted. He says recent changes to the state's death penalty laws only drag out the already lengthy appeals process. Just last year, the Florida Supreme Court ruled all jury recommendations for the death penalty must now be unanimous.
Then the lawyers say, wait a minute, this should apply to my client, and you start all over again.
We are living murder victims, you know, because we have to deal with this. It doesn't stop.
Pat Schwiebe says the constant stream of appeals only prolongs her family's pain.
I don't care if it was turned over, his sentence was turned over to life in prison. That would be a situation for me to then be able to say, all right, we're done. Let's move on.
Now, Shields was sentenced to life in prison. He does plan to ask for an early release, though, sometime in the near future. I also reached out to Foster and the two other teens arrested in this case, but they never answered my letters. For the NBC2 investigators, I'm Trent Kelly.
Call, email, or download the NBC2 News app and submit your tip now.